Hello everybody, welcome to VESCH webinar on how to measure vascular aging and who might benefit from measuring of vascular aging. So my name is Julia Vitsuchovska, I'm from Latvia, and I'm hosting this webinar. VESCH.net, I would like to remind, is a network of researchers from Europe, USA, Australia, researchers who are working together to refine, harmonize, and promote the use of vascular aging measures in order to improve clinical practice and reduce the burden of cardiovascular disease globally. Before we get started, I would like to run over a few housekeeping points. First of all, we would prefer all the answers to be answered afterwards. So after Rosa Maria Bruna is giving her lecture. So perfect if you type your questions with the chat, and we will answer everything. So then your microphone should be muted. If not, please make sure it is muted now. Secondly, this webinar is to be live streamed on to YouTube and will be recorded and shared on our website following the webinar. So finally, we will not be able to assist with any technical difficulties and imperfections throughout the webinar. And in general, it is all about technical and organizational issues, and I'm happy to give the word to Rosa Maria Bruna from Paris University. So please, Rosa Maria.
So good morning, everybody. It is really a pleasure to be here with you, and an honor too, because it's really an honor to speak after Stefan Laurent and Kuhn Riesing. And I am a researcher at the University of Paris. I am a physician by education, and I work at the I've worked in the last 10-15 years on biomarkers of vascular aging. So I will share my screen so that we can start our presentation. Okay, so my talk will be about how to measure vascular aging and who is benefiting most from these measurements. So, of course, this presentation will be in two parts, dealing with these two major points, which I must admit that it is a difficult task to summarize in half an hour all this subject, so I will necessarily skip some points and focus only on some aspects. So let's start with how to measure vascular aging. So as a general framework, vascular aging, you already know what vascular aging is, because I suppose that you follow also the webinar number one. And so how to measure? We can measure vascular aging in the vasculature, and we can measure vascular aging with molecular and cellular biomarkers. If we focus on the arteries, we can study large arteries or small arteries. We can use functional tests or structural tests, and we can use invasive or non-invasive tests. So this is the general framework. I tried to summarize different techniques in only one slide. But for the purposes of the presentation, I will speak only about large arteries, I will speak only about non-invasive tests. And we are speaking mostly about the phenomenon of atherosclerosis, which first steps is of course endothelial dysfunction, and about arterial stiffness. So let's start with the first topic, so atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis is a gradual phenomenon that goes on throughout all the lifetime. And at the beginning, we have only functional alteration. So the vessel is completely normal, but it has lost its main functionalities. And then with the aging and with the risk factors, we can accumulate some structural alteration characteristics of atherosclerosis. So we have plaques, we have stenosis, and we have calcifications. So let's start with endothelial function and dysfunction. So endothelial dysfunction is the first step of atherosclerosis, the functional one. And we can define endothelial dysfunction as a reduced availability of nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a gas which is used as a transmitter and produced by the endothelium. This is a very complex slide to explain you how it is, how complex is the regulation of nitric oxide. But you must bear in mind that the main effect of nitric oxide is relaxation of smooth muscle cells. So the nitric oxide is produced in the endothelial cells and then act in a paracrine way on the smooth muscle cells. Then it has effect on the platelets, so it can induce platelet inhibition. It has effects on thrombolysis and also on vascular growth. So all the effects of nitric oxide are vasculoprotective. The main enemy of nitric oxide are reactive oxygen species. So reactive oxygen species, which are increased with aging and with the risk factors, reduce the availability of NO. They transform NO in nitric compounds, which are not only not functional for protection, but also induce some damage. And you can see that the release of nitric oxide is regulated by many molecules. So we have several enzymes, several receptor on endothelial cells who can trigger the production and the release of nitric oxide. And there is also a mechanical stimuli for NO production, which is a shear cell. So it is clear from this slide that we can measure the endothelial dysfunction by measure the reactivity of the vessels to different stimuli. Can be some molecules that stimulate NO release by link to their receptor, or the mechanical stimuli, which is the shear stress. This is why, because it's very difficult to measure directly nitric oxide. It is a gas, it is a very short half-life. So the way to measure endothelial function is to measure the vessel reactivity to stimuli. So we will measure the induced NO release. So if we restrict the test for endothelial dysfunction to non-invasive tests on large arteries, we come up with only one test, more or less, which is brachial artery flow mediated dilation. This test was developed first time in 1992 by the John Dinfield Lab. And here you can see the first publication showing that flow mediated dilation is reduced in children with familial hypercholesterolemia. And this test is based on stimulating NO release by increasing the shear stress in the brachial artery. And how we can increase the shear stress in the brachial artery? Simply, we can inflate a blood pressure cuff in the forearm, and we can stop the blood flow, stop the blood flowing for 5 minutes, I would say. When we release the cuff, we have, of course, a vasodilation in all the district of the arm and the hand, which is a reactive vasodilation. This will stimulate an increased flow velocity in the brachial artery. in this, we can measure the increased flow velocity in the brachial artery. This is a stimulus for, it will increase the attrition of the blood on the vessel wall. So it increases the shear stress. The shear stress will induce in a few seconds a release of nitric oxide, which is inducing a dilation of the brachial artery. This means that we can measure, for example, by ultrasound, this change in diameter. The change in diameter is the percentage change in diameter upon the baseline diameter is the flow-mediated dilation. Flow-mediated dilation is, as already said, used from several decades, and there are many studies. This is a summary of the meta-analysis studying the predictive value of flow-mediated dilation in cardiovascular prognosis. And you can see that, let's have a look simply on the last meta-analysis here. You can see that 1% increase in flow-mediated dilation is associated with 12% less cardiovascular events. This is, it is demonstrated both in high risk and low risk populations and different age classes. Here you can see a scheme summarizing how to perform flow mediated dilation. It is quite important to standardize the conditional requirement because it is a functional test. It is, its beauty, I would say, is it is very responsive to changes in the condition. So it is, for example, if you administer a drug, you can have a change in the flow mediated dilation in a few hours. If you are doing an exercise, physical activity, you can have a response in flow-mediated dilation soon after. So this means also that we can have a lot of confounders. So it's very important to standardize subject preparation. Then the other important things is to standardize the protocol of acquisition. So we recommend to use, for example, a stereotactic probe holder for the ultrasound probe. Otherwise, movements induced by the operator are visible, and it's important to standardize the time. So we have, for example, we opted for 5 minutes cuff inflation and at least 3 minutes of recording after. And the most important thing is the trained operator. So it's a technique which is that you have to learn to do it. So this is also the most important limitation of the technique. The acquisition should be done with a automatic edge detection system in order to have stable measurements and reliable and reproducible measurements. And they should be reported in a standardized way. And what it is important, it is, okay, we are measuring endothelial function in the brachial artery, but it is tightly related to what is happening in the epicardial arteries, in the coronary arteries. And what is remarkable, it is that all the studies demonstrated a weak correlation between coronary endothelial function and brachial endothelial function. Most recent studies using a standardized methodology, they demonstrated a tighter correlation between the two measurements. So it means that it is a sort of demonstration that atherosclerosis, it's really a systemic phenomenon. So you can study the brachial artery, but have a window to the heart too. So in summary, I have no time to explain all these bullet points, but I would like to summarize some important points on the technique. So flow-mediated dilation is associated with age and risk factors. It predicts events in low and high-risk populations. Flow-mediated dilation changes over time predict prognosis of the patients, which is very important. So if somebody, after a treatment, he is not normalizing his endothelial function, he can have a worse prognosis than somebody who normalizes flow-mediated dilation after treatment. And it is excellent for pathophysiological studies because we are measuring the first step of atherosclerosis, so a functional stage. So it is possible to study new phenomena in this with this kind of measurements. It is useful as a surrogate point for pharmacological study because it is highly responsive to changes, and so we can measure the effect of treatment with this test. Technique is standardized, but only very recently. So there are still many labs who don't use standardized techniques. As a limitation, I would say, we have no reference values published yet, but this will come soon. And the studies demonstrating, comparing the additive value of a flow-mediated dilation on top of classical risk score demonstrated the absence of additive value. This is very important for it. It's a clearly a strong limitation for the use of flow-mediated dilation in clinical practice. We must admit that these studies were performed when the technique was less standardized than now. So we can imagine that this can change in new studies. And the clear limitation is the need of an expert operator. It means that it is a test which is not so suitable for large use in and wide use in clinical practice. I would say this kind of test is more useful for other purposes. Then we will speak about carotid intima media thickness. This technique was developed first in Italy in 1986. And it's the measurement of, or usually on the far wall of the carotid artery, of the intima media complex, which appears like an echogenic interface followed by an echolucent interface. It is there are really a lot of publication about intima media thickness. It is clear that intima media thickness increases with age. There are reference values for intima media thickness too. This is the publication of the reference values. It predicts cardiovascular events in a graded manner. So it is a clear sign of it is progressing with the increasing risk. But we should recognize that it may reflect non-atherosclerotic processes. What does it mean? It means that this is a measure of the complex intima media. Atherosclerosis, it's an intimal phenomenon. We are measuring also the media. So changes in the smooth muscle tone or smooth muscle hypertrophy affects intima media and is not necessarily a sign of atherosclerosis. For example, this is a publication we released last year, and you can see that, for example, a subject performing a triathlon competition, which is an endurance competition with bike running and swimming for 11 hours. This kind of endurance sport, it is able to reduce carotid IMT, and clearly it's not a regression of atherosclerosis. It's a post-exercise vasodilation, and so a change of the thickness of the muscular component. But the main limitation for IMT use in clinical practice, I would say, is that its regression does not predict reduction in cardiovascular event. It's really a structural alteration. It is permanent, I would say. And the changes in IMT are not an index of an improved status of the patient. So many people believe now that it's better to measure other carotid ultrasound parameters, such as plaques or stenosis. So you can measure, as you can see in this slide, we can have single plaques in the carotid that could be calcified or not calcified, or we can have multiple plaques. So even in this case, we can have different echo density of plaques. So what does it mean? It means that we can measure thickness, but we can measure also burden. So we can simply count the number of plaques in the carotid tree bilaterally and in the different segments. But we can also use a quantified system to measure plaque burden. For example, this is a 3D reconstruction of several 2D scans of the carotid artery. And so we can have a plaque volume, overall plaque volume of a carotid artery. So this is a very busy slide, but it's just to convey you one message that plaque burden, it is more correlated with, for example, coronary atherosclerosis than intima media thickness, but also it's better than ABI, ankle bladder index, another measure of sclerosis. So it means that plaque burden, it has the potential of being a good biomarker for vascular aging. And indeed, it is able to have an increased discrimination in comparison to IMT and an increased net reclassification index. This is a very important concept. When we are speaking about biomarkers of vascular aging, we should assess not only correlation with the risk factors, but also the discrimination and the reclassification index. The latter means the possibility to reclassify risk of people. If with the standard classical score, we can consider that the people is labeled as at low risk, we can measure the number of persons that are reclassified to a different risk category by adding a new biomarker. And in this very interesting study that I'm presenting to you, interesting is also that plaque thickness and plaque burden has the same discrimination and net reclassification power. It means that a simple measure like plaque thickness is as accurate as the complex plaque burden that I showed to you in the previous slide. So in summary, we can say that IMT and plaques are associated with age and risk factors. Reference values exist for IMT. Prediction of cardiovascular events was demonstrated. These techniques are simply and widely available. Measuring parameters like plaque thickness, it's really easy for an operator to learn how to do it. Limitations are that for IMT, we have no additive value on classical risk score assessment, but for plaques we have indeed. And we have, this is the main limitation, no predictive value for changing in these parameters. So let's move to arterial stiffness. You know already a lot about arterial stiffness because this was the main objective of webinar number one and number two. So I will go quite quickly for this technique. I concentrated the most energy to speak about atherosclerosis in this webinar. But you know very well that aortic stiffening is really a consequence of aging. It's really the wear and tear of the elastin fibers reacting to the heartbeat cycles. So it's a phenomenon which is really related with aging. So aging causes elastin fiber rupture, and this results in aortic stiffness. Aortic stiffness then can induce systolic hypertension, which increase the hemodynamic load on the arteries, and so can stimulate the development of further aortic stiffness, but as an impact on the other target organs, so on the heart, on the brain, and on the kidney. There are several techniques to measure arterial stiffness. We can measure arterial stiffness in the aorta, and both invasively and non-invasively. And we can measure local arterial stiffness. And these two kind of measurements, distensibility and stiffness, are related but are not the same. So you already discussed this aspect with in the Kuhn Wiesing seminar, so I will not go through this relationship. But I will concentrate only on arterial stiffness measured by pulse velocity, because you already discussed a lot about the carotid mechanics and distensibility in the previous webinar. So there are, of course, some assumptions and some limitation in the use of pulse velocity as an index of arterial stiffness. So we use a model imagining that aorta is a uniform elastic tube free of reflection, and if infinitely long, which of course is not the case, and we have a limitation that pulse velocity depends on the operating pressure, because at different levels of pressure, the fiber bearing the load of the hemodynamic load are the elastin fibers. Is that stiffness is measured as an average of the entire aorta, which is, I would say, the most interesting vessel for this purpose. And we don't need the simultaneous assessment of pressure and area, which could be very difficult for aorta with non-invasive techniques. So pulse velocity is usually measured as the velocity of the pressure waves between carotid and the femoral arteries. This could be done simultaneously with the devices like this. And so it's very easy to measure the transit time between the foot of the two waves in the carotid and in the femoral artery. And then, of course, when you simply measure the distance between these two points, it is very easy to calculate the velocity with the space and time. And otherwise, we can measure successive recordings and then use the ECG as a reference. There was some discussion about how to measure the distance, because with a tailored tape, we can measure external distance between two points, but we are not really measuring the aortic path lengths. But the best way to approximate the real aortic path length seems to be the direct distance between the carotid and the femoral artery multiplied for 0.8. And so current guidelines for pulse velocity suggest recommend this kind of measurement. As I told you, I will not speak about carotid geometry and stiffness. You know already everything about compliance, distensibility, stiffness, and young elastic modulus from the previous webinar. We have reference values for pulse velocity that were published in 2010, and clearly showing that pulse velocity is increasing with age. Aortic stiffness is related with all cardiovascular risk factors, but also it is increased in non-cardiovascular diseases and in inflammatory diseases. And I will develop this point. I will develop the second part of this seminar, mostly with examples from pulse velocity. So let's move to the second part of the presentation. Who is benefiting most from the measurement of vascular aging? So first step we should do before moving to this point is why measuring vascular aging? Very briefly, we need to measure vascular aging in order to identify accurately people at risk of cardiovascular events and set up appropriate preventive strategies and treatment in this population. So we have a clearly clinical objective to measure vascular aging. But we have also research objectives, I would say. So we can use vascular aging biomarkers for pathophysiological studies, and we can use vascular aging biomarkers as surrogate biomarkers in interventional pharmacological trials. So, but when we are looking at our guidelines to assess cardiovascular risk in the general population, we can see that the only recommended test for this assessment is SCORE. So it's the total cardiovascular risk estimation using a score including sex, age, blood pressure, cholesterol, and smoking. This is the only recommended test to be used in all apparently healthy individuals. This is a very simple approach, very effective, I would say, but with some limitation. First, this score is validated to provide 10-year risk for cardiovascular mortality. It means that it is strongly influenced by the age of the individual. It is not so accurate to identify people at risk where they are young and their risk of dying for a cardiovascular event is low. And the other huge limitation is that score is validated only between 40 and 65 years old people. So this is a very tight window for human lifetime. American scores, for example, the pool cohort equation are in this sense better because they can be used between 20 and 79 years old. But still, there are the age extreme that are not included in this score. And finally, they can be used only in primary prevention. There are different scores for secondary prevention, of course. So the advantage of measuring vascular aging biomarker compared to the score is that the score is changing with the changing of blood pressure, of lipids, and so on. And so it is not reflecting the overall burden of risk factors on the arteries. And while measuring directly in the arteries their status can provide an integrated marker of cardiovascular burden. And the other important limitation is that score is not including of course, unknown risk factors, but is not included also a lot of known risk factors, and which can be assessed by using a vascular aging biomarker. So the guidelines include some techniques, some imaging methods that can be used to refine risk, because of course these limitations are well known by people writing the guidelines. And in particular, recommended tests are coronary artery calcium scoring, atherosclerotic plaque detection, ankle brachial index, while carotid ultrasound IMT is not recommended. And these tests are used specifically when in people with low to moderate risk and in people close to the threshold. The threshold of 5% is the threshold between the low to moderate risk and the high risk. So they recommend to use these tests to refine risk in these populations. As you can see, there are no markers of arterial stiffness. There are only markers of atherosclerosis and we have no biomarkers of arteriosclerosis. This is why for the next part of the presentation, I will present only tests for the other part, for the arteriosclerosis, so that you can have a complete view. So, it has been demonstrated by this meta-analysis of 70,000 individuals in 29 studies that pulse velocity improves risk classification. And improves risk classification in particular, it is very performant, it is very effective, in particular in individuals in intermediate risk only. This is what is written in this table that probably you cannot see so well. And a really nice sub-analysis showed that the largest impact for pulse velocity to reclassify risk is for the young people, for people under 50 years, because of this is a clear limitation of the classical scores that we used, those one including only classical risk factors. And this other paper from Sehested in another cohort showed that the same thing, that the reclassification power pathway velocity is greater in individual at low to moderate risk, those one with a score lower than 5%. And this is really clinically relevant because you can see that these individuals that who have a score less than 5% and they have subclinical organ damage, so measured with pulse velocity, but also with other techniques, they have indeed a risk of having a cardiovascular death, which is very similar to those classified as more than 5%. So it's really an important and relevant reclassification power. So this is for the general population. But then I would like to speak about some special population in which the assessment of vascular aging could be even more beneficial. And as already said, SCORE doesn't work in age extreme, cannot be applied in age extreme. But if we have a look to the age distribution in the world, you can see that people between 25 and 64 years of age, there are less than a half of the general population. So it's even strange to speak about age extreme. This is really a large part of the population in which this kind of biomarkers could be useful. And the largest impact is in the young, is in the youth. So there's really a sort of emergency about cardiovascular disease in the young. They are exposed to very often to an unhealthy lifestyle. So with the increased salt intake, obesity, reduced physical activity, smoking, and also low socioeconomic status, these things can lead to an increased cardiovascular risk in the young, which then has consequences throughout all their future lifetime. So it is clear that this unhealthy lifestyle is linked to obesity and to hypertension. And obesity and hypertension in the childhood are related to a reduced carotid elasticity in adulthood. This is what has been shown by the Young Finn study, this publication that you are seeing in the slide. But there are also other studies, for example, this Portuguese study showed that indeed, if we define EVA, early vascular aging, as the ninth percentile of the reference values for pulse velocity, you can see that in the age lower than 30 years old, 40% of the individuals have an early vascular aging. So another evidence showing that the use of vascular aging biomarkers is particularly useful in the young. And what it is good is that if we have an impact, if we modify lifestyle, for example, if we improve the ideal cardiovascular health score, this Life Simple 7, indeed in childhood and adolescence, then in the adulthood, we will have a lower pulse velocity. So it's not a static parameter. It's not already decided at birth, and it's not already decided but by your lifestyle. You can, if you modify your lifestyle, you can really reduce your vascular age. What it is very important that it is also the opposite relationship. So increased pulse velocity during adolescence then can trigger hypertension in adulthood. So it is very important to stop this vicious circle as soon as possible. And this can be the people who should have access to effective preventive strategies must be identified and they could be identified with the use of vascular aging biomarkers. One particular application of vascular aging biomarkers, and in particular arterial stiffness and central blood pressure, is in the dissection of phenotyping of hypertension in the young, which is a very complex issue that we have no time to discuss in detail, but we can have hypertension in the young associated with increased arterial stiffness. These forms are particularly dangerous in terms of cardiovascular risk. And we can have forms of, for example, of isolated systolic hypertension, which are less, which have less risk because they, this pattern correspond to a lower central blood pressure. So this is why, for example, in the diagnostic flowchart for the assessment of isolated systolic hypertension in the young, central blood pressure is included, because it can help identify really people with a high risk profile or with a low risk profile. So we spoke about the young, now we are going to speak about the elderly. And in the elderly, one you should consider that the real public health emergency is dementia and cognitive decline. And this phenomenon is indeed induced by vascular risk factors. And this is true for vascular dementia, but it is true indeed also for Alzheimer's dementia. And it is very important that individuals with a high pulse velocity, for example, in the in this study, these individuals, they have a really a rapid cognitive decline of, over time. This is due to the effect of, probably is due to the effect of pulsatility, or transmission of pulsatility in the brain, which is increased when the large arteries are stiffer. And arterial stiffness, it is related also with the brain damage measured by MRI, so with white matter hyperintensities. And you can see that one standard deviation in pulse width velocity in the Framingham Offspring study is associated with 1.2 years more of brain aging in terms of structural brain alterations. Furthermore, arterial stiffness is able to identify subjects at higher risk of cognitive decline, even among the very, very old and fragile patients in nursing home. And some data suggest also that there's the stiffening effect of antihypertensive drugs that then results in a better profile in terms of cognitive impairment. Chronic kidney disease is, I would say, a really dramatic condition in terms of cardiovascular events. And in this, the impairment of renal function has a lot of negative effects on the arterial walls. And in this population, arterial stiffness measured by pulse width velocity can predict both mortality and, for example, heart failure development, as you can see in this slide. And what it is particularly important is that chronic kidney disease is since now, the only condition in which the predictive value of pulse velocity changes has been demonstrated. So individuals with chronic kidney disease in which antihypertensive treatment is not able to normalize pulse velocity, to reduce pulse velocity, these individuals have a worse prognosis. And what it is really important is that this effect is blood pressure independent. So you can see here in survivors and not survivors, we have a similar reduction of blood pressure for treatment, the black lines, but only the individuals who survived had also a reduction in pulse velocity. While in the other individuals, the non-survivors, the trend was for an increase in pulse velocity. Finally, we will speak about inflammation. Inflammation is chronic inflammation, but also acute inflammation indeed, is able to really have a large impact on the vasculature, both on the smooth muscle cells, but also in the immune mediated damage of the arteries, resulting then in extracellular matrix damage. There are increasing evidence about the relationship between endothelial damage, accelerated atheromatosis, and arterial stiffening, which are increased in chronic inflammation, chronic inflammatory diseases, and also in vasculitis. Finally, just to remind you that we are all, of course, we are all very involved in what's happening in the rest of the world with the COVID infection. And just would like to remind you that COVID-19 indeed is also an endothelitis. So the virus is able to directly infect the endothelial cells, and there's the possibility that we can have a long-term consequences on vascular damage. So it is probable that vascular aging biomarkers can be useful in stratifying cardiovascular risk after exposure to novel cardiovascular risk factors like COVID-19 probably. So COVID-19 can directly affect the vessels, but can also act on the vasculature by inducing systemic inflammation or by inducing psychological consequences, which are also able to increase arterial stiffness. So just would like to remind you the protocol that we are conducting together with the Artery Society and the VASCAGE-NET, which is aimed at studying the long-term consequences of COVID-19 on vascular damage. So I move to the conclusions. Conclusion number one is that, it is possible to measure non-invasively at with low cost reproducible standardized technique, both atherosclerosis and arteriosclerosis, which are, I would say, two sides of the same story, a little bit like Edward Norton and Brad Pitt in Fight Club. And if I would say who benefits most from vascular aging assessment, I would say that patient at low moderate risk, the young, the elderly, the individuals with chronic kidney disease, with inflammatory disease. So there are really a large population who can be who can benefit from these measurements. And I would say that these are not really special conditions, because everybody's special. So everybody has their story to tell, and everybody might need a more accurate and better assessment of cardiovascular disease. So I thank you for the attention, and I hope that I can give some contribution to this difficult topic. And I will be really happy to answer your questions.
Thank you, Rosa, so much. Indeed, it was a very helpful overview and update of the information which is available, and even from my point of view, some hints in whom profile of our patients, considering age and cardiovascular risk, from available biomarkers might be more or less helpful. I see that we have first question. Can you see it, or I can?
Yes.
Yeah, please. Yeah, from Patrick.
A question from Patrick Seegers. Should we use different cutoff values for IMT for men and women, or a better use the wall area? So this is a difficult question, because I went on to this presentation with the hypothesis that indeed we don't have to measure carotid IMT because it's not the best biomarker of vascular aging that we have. And for the question about wall area, it's, I think, very interesting, because wall area is combining not only IMT, but also diameter. And diameter, I had no time to speak about this aspect too during this presentation, but indeed, diameter, increased diameter can be considered as a marker of vascular aging because it's a form of remodeling which is induced by elastin fibrous degradation exactly like arterial stiffness. So it is conceivable that wall area, by combining these two measurements, IMT and diameter, can be a good biomarker of vascular aging. The limitation that I see, and this is also a limitation coming from the studies already published about the predictive value of diameter in the carotid, for example, is that probably we are dealing with a sort of non-modifiable damage. It's quite difficult to modify diameter, no? To regress diameter alterations, regress dilation. So I fear that the predictive value of this measure, in particular the predictive value of changes, could be reduced. And the other thing is wall area. Wall area is diameter, but is AMT. So even in that case, we are considering wall hypertrophy, which not necessarily corresponds to atherosclerosis. So there's also a lack of specificity due to this. And of course, I am speaking of mostly of the carotid when I'm speaking about this. This could be not true with different arterial districts. Okay, so, are there any questions?
Thank you. I see no raised hands, no questions within chat, but I have a question. I have two questions actually. From the guidelines of European Society of Cardiology, pulse wave velocity as a marker of efficacy of the treatment is mentioned as a marker with high reproducibility. Yeah, so quite as I understand, we can use it within our researchers as quite quickly responding marker. Yeah, so, but what about this flow measurement devices, FMD? How quickly do we expect changes beyond treatment, for example?
So I would say for arterial stiffness measurements in general, to have changes with treatment, it is we should wait at least 6 months, 1 year of a different treatment before having a change. But then the change is measurable. And as you see also with the chronic kidney disease data that I show, it's also, there are changes which are blood pressure independent. So it's, we are really measuring we are measuring something that could have an added value on blood pressure too, for example. And when are you speaking, can you explain better what do you mean for a flow measurement?
So this, when do we apply this? When we set our endpoints and would like to measure this FMD, for example, yeah. So to follow up changes beyond our treatment, yeah. Whether these changes are also, so you mentioned that these are sensitive and specific. Changes, yeah, but whether these are reproducible, so, and whether we expect the same, for example, time period, 6 months of improvement, so to make re-measurement in 6 months.
I would say that this is, I think the field of research on vascular aging biomarker in which we have less data, changing the parameter over time. So I think that this is one of the reasons why we have we don't have so much of arterial stiffness in the guidelines. So I really think that as also as this cost action, this Vascage Net, we should really work on promote and analyze repeated data, repeated measurements, because we really have very few information. As
okay.
I told
you, open question. Yeah.
For pulse velocity with carotid thermal pulse velocity, which is the oldest, I would say, measurement of stiffness. And then for the other, it's even worse. So it will be really important to have more data about this. So for this, we have to work. I have no clear answer.
Thank you. We have two more questions from Elizabeth and Tanish. Can you see?
Not yet.
Elizabeth, how can we manage all these different quantitative sources of information? Should we try in the future to integrate measurements of different vascular aging parameters to obtain a customized risk evaluation?
So, I would say this is a pathway that it is already taken by some researcher. There are some very initial publication about integrated biomarker of vascular aging. For example, there's a publication in the Malmö study coming out last year about integrating the predictive value of pulse velocity and IMT. So really atherosclerosis and arteriosclerosis. Maybe we can do better because, as I already said, IMT is not the best biomarker of atherosclerosis. I think that it is something that could be useful, but we should also bear in mind that we should keep things simple, because if I convinced you about this framework, everybody benefits from vascular aging measurements, then it means that the approach we chose should be really, 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 really simple and applicable to the general population. So a single, the integrated biomarker we are going to choose should be also simple to measure and not possibly acquiring data with the same technique and the same 5 minutes test and having all the answers. We should. This is, of course, it's a work of technology and not only on clinicians, but it is, I think, a valuable objective.
Okay, thank you. We are to finish, but there is one more question. Can you see from Anish Bova? Could you outline why differences arise in association between outcome measures, prognostic CV events, and distensibility, and all pulse wave velocity? Which would you suggest using for patients' research, or would you use both?
So we are talking about pulse wave velocity and?
And distensibility. Distensibility.
So carotid distensibility, for example. So if I have to choose only one test, so for stratification of risk, since now we have more evidence with the carotid femoral pulse velocity than with the other techniques. For carotid distensibility, we have a lot of evidence about predictive value for mortality from stroke, a little bit less for coronary artery disease. And the same is true for carotid diameters, for example. So it seems that when we are looking at the carotid, we are probably really looking on what's happening towards the brain. And in terms of data about net reclassification index, so for example, we have more solid evidence with the pulse velocity since now. But this does not mean that things cannot change in the future. It's simply, if I have to do a snapshot of the current situation, I would say like this.
Thank you, Rosa. Thank you so much. And thanks to everybody who joined us today. I remind you that next webinar number 4, will take place in September, and this will be given by Peter Nielsen from Sweden. And the topic is, why do some people display early vascular aging compared to others? How can I modify vascular aging? Vitally important topic, and I hope we will join together in September to watch this webinar and to share our opinions on this topic. Thank you again. Thank you to everybody. Stay safe and healthy. I have to finish today's event. Yeah. Thank you, Rosa.
Goodbye to everybody.
Bye-bye.